We've talked about various aspects of bootstrapping a lot on Computerphile, going way back, I think, to a Tom Rodden video 3 or 4 years ago now, which is doing very well.
Dilemma of the chicken and the egg.
He talks very well about the essential nature of bootstrapping and so on, but he very carefully avoids going into detail because it does get complicated. The way I've always found best to teach it is to use a tool called T-diagrams, which you just draw for yourself. I'm going to explain via T-diagrams what it means to bootstrap. Bootstrap a system like an assembler or a compiler or whatever. But first of all, what is a T-diagram? Draw me a T-diagram. Let us assume that you have written a program in Bell Labs C language. You are very, very proud of this program. You think it's absolutely wonderful and will win an award and all that. This is the input to your program. This is the output from your program. And at this level, I can say, what does that mean? It means that the program was written in. I've chosen C deliberately because it's low level, it's fairly close to the hardware. Something like this, I hope you'll all recognise. You're writing a simple program in a simple language, and you're delighted when your high-level statements produce, ultimately, this thing. I will try not to fall back into 80s usage and say it produces a core image. They even called it that at Bell Labs. No, it's an executable. Okay, well, we all know that it's all very well saying, I'll write it in C. It's going to have this input. It will produce that output. The next question is, but how do you convert that C into a runnable executable binary, which will be your program? You have to get that C translated. And here you begin to see the power of T-diagrams. Draw this one again. Input, output. It's written in C. Now, here's the clever bit. Positioning another T block like that up against this one shows you how this has to be processed. What you need is something that will turn your C program statements into a working binary on the machine you're working on. You may say, but where did this come from? Somebody provided me with a thing that is capable of taking in C statements. It is itself an executable binary. It's running on my ARM chip or my Intel or my Apple or whatever. This is my C compiler, of course. That's got to have come from somewhere, but we'll get into that later. So there's the C compiler, and if you feed the C language for your master program through that compiler, you know what happens. It produces an A.out on Unix, or an executable binary. The net effect of slotting that T-diagram against here slightly downwards is to show you that the C you've written gets converted into binary, and the net output from this process, it produces out a program that you probably store in a file somewhere, which is like this left-hand side, only a little bit different because it's now input, output. But look, what has happened during the compilation process is that by compiling your C statements for your program, it drinks them in as data. The compiler itself is a binary running on your architecture that you're perfectly happy with. It is squirting out executable binary. So I can write in here, let's say that's my output binary code. But that output binary code, I'll stick with the pink, I will write bin in here to show you that that is what the compiler has done for you. You think of it as input producing output, and I wrote it in C, and you close your eyes as to what happens. It just works. But your binary, your A.out, your ultimate executable, will take your input, will produce perfect output first time, of course, but it is essentially written in binary and has to be to execute directly on the hardware. That has been produced by a C compiler. And the T-diagram for a C compiler is this. I accept as input C. I am a runnable binary, otherwise I won't work at all, but I have code generation capabilities. I generate binary that will run, and that is your user executable. And here's the first point I want to make. The quality of the binary that actually is your compiler running may be very different from the quality of the binary that it spits out as a translation of your program. They may be very similar, Or it could be that the C compiler is actually very, very slow at producing your output binary. But if it gets there in the end, you don't care. It could be ultra fast. It could be that you've written a C compiler that's so bad that the output that it produces for you is worse than it itself is using. I hope you all get the hang here. There's not necessarily any direct link between the quality of the binary you are running to make the C compiler work, as opposed to the binary it is spitting out for your program as its translation. They may be related, they may be close, and all this. What I think now I will try and do for you is to take the story one stage backwards and start speculating about how the heck did I get the C compiler? Is it something that Ken Thompson handed over, or Dennis Ritchie handed over to me already made? It could have been. Or you might say, Dennis, how did you implement that C compiler? And he will say, well, the first version I wrote off the back of an assembler. And of course, this goes on recursively forever. But Dennis, who wrote the assembler, you know, and back and back and back, right down to squirting ones and zeros in on hand keys. No, let's presume for the next stage of the story that from somewhere your little machine did also come with an assembler for low-level programming, for filling in the bits that maybe the C compiler for one reason or another isn't suitable for. Well, how is that done in T-diagram terms? And by looking at how the assembler is done, we can then see how it's possible to bootstrap off an assembler version of something to a higher level version. An assembler is like a compiler, except for those of you who've done it, you know, in every sense, an assembler is at a lower level. Assemblers, and particularly macro assemblers, they'll give you vestigial capability to do an array, but they may not have structures. Almost certainly won't. They're a higher level construct, you see. So you're down with simple add, subtract, statements, you can move about memory, you've got to understand pointers, we've done lots of those. You do them at the assembler level, you're in charge, you must keep track of what your pointers are doing, so on and so on and so on. It's just a simpler view of the world and a more detailed and complicated one in several ways. I'll call it AC, and that stands for assembler input. Now, you expect that assembler to produce you a runnable executable binary. Well, I'm going to write this in here as saying that the code generation from the assembler is going to produce me what I'll call a binary of type A. It's produced from an assembler. It's an assembler quality binary. It depends on the who wrote the code generator for the assembler as to how good that bin A is. Now, here's the thing again you'll have to get your head round and get used to. This is a U. Bin U. I don't know how this was developed, this assembler. All I know is I met Ken in the corridor, David Wheeler at Cambridge in the corridor, and I said, hey, here's the assembler I use. They handed over an executable, and I did not ask questions about how that in itself may have been bootstrapped out of nothing. They just said, here's an assembler, it works, use it. So, okay, I say thank you. I'm in at the midpoint of an endless sequence of bootstrapping, but I can build on top of an assembler to build a C compiler, shall we say. So you put assembler codes in. Of course, the unknown provenance binary is whirring away, and that is executing the assembler code. And out it comes as binary of type A, which you can put in a file, be an A.out file under Unix, it could be whatever. You can store it in a file, you can invoke it, you can execute it. And the only difference from what's gone before is that the assembler code is at a lower sophistication level than your C would be. A lot of you know, again, I keep harking back to Bell Labs history, largely because it's very good for illustrating this thing. You can say, look, this really happened. This really is what Dennis and Ken did. This is what you have to be aware of. Dennis said to Ken, and Ken says to Dennis, for the next version of the Unix operating system, we've got to write it in something higher level. It drives you mad writing it in assembler because there's no easy way of keeping track of pointers. There's no structures. In fact, in a recent video now out there in the wild somewhere, Ken Thompson admits, he said, our first three attempts to write Unix in a higher level language, and Dennis was developing C. The first three attempts I tried, I'm Ken Thompson, failed. Why did they fail? I found later, the fourth attempt, Dennis had put structures in C, and that's what I needed, because they automatically keep track of offsets and pointers. Wonderful. Okay, so here we are then, back in that kind of era. We are wanting to create a C language compiler, but we are writing it at assembly code level. It is going to produce a binary. But going back to what we said last time, because it came out of an assembler era, we're going to presume that the binary that this thing produces is what we call binary A. It came via an assembler route, did this executable. Fine, but then you look at that and say, hey, come on, this is brushing over certain details. You can't directly execute assembler unless somebody's written an assembler interpreter for you, but there again, no, they haven't. That assembler coding has got to be converted into a binary. But how do you turn the assembler coding into a binary? Answer, slot up another T-diagram and visualize what goes on. There just happens to be, hanging around, because Ken gave it to us in the corridor, a thing called an assembler. And the assembler accepts any old assembler code you like, produces what we'll call bin A, an executable binary, but it came out of an assembler. And that, the assembler itself, the binary is of unknown provenance. Ken did it in absolute binary off the top of his head. Probably not. But somebody labored long and hard to write a thing that really works as an assembler on this particular machine that you are working on. What you need to do is to feed the assembler code that implements your C compiler into the assembler itself to assemble it. You've got to assemble the assembly code that is the compiler. And it goes in as assembler coding. It's running on its own binary. You're thinking, will it crash? No, it won't. Ken wrote it. You know, this sort of thing. That whirs around and it converts the assembler code into binary of quality A. That binary of quality A, when it's produced, you can store in a file. It's an executable. It's an A.out file. And then you have created a thing which takes in C, produces binary A, assembler coding. So your net output here then is the following. It's C. It spits out an executable binary for you, the C compiler. So we now have a C compiler that is not just, as it were, implemented at the assembly code level, but that assembly code has been translated into a binary so that the C compiler can actually run on real hardware. And once again, let's trace through. The assembler code that implements the C compiler is fed into the assembler. This thing whirs round and round like mad, but the assembler code statements that are the compiler get translated into bin of quality A, and that's the implementation vehicle for your new C compiler. You have produced a C compiler by building it out of an assembler, by using the assembler as the next stage along, which you have to do. The assembler converts the assembler code that is the C compiler into being a workable, runnable binary of quality A. So that's the first start of your compiler, is to say we're doing bootstrapping. We've come up off an assembler solution. We wrote in our high-level language, and here we are, our very, very first C compiler. Is there a problem with it? Not really, except that all we want to do here is to say, well, we want a C compiler that'll produce runnable binary of some sort. And then we say, hey, but the only tool we've got to making a binary for this C compiler is the assembler itself, right? The assembler produces bin A, so you're stuck with that. So can you see that by running the assembler there and making it squirt out binary A quality equivalent to the assembler code that is the compiler, you end up with a C compiler Mark 1 that spits out bin A but is running on bin A. We're at the mercy of bin of quality A, the assembler quality binary. Is it good? Is it bad? Could we do better? Yeah, We'll stop there, but just as a marker for what's coming, if your head isn't aching yet, that thing is building a compiler off an assembler. When that is working, what do you do to make it better? You rewrite it, and you make a new version of a C compiler that produces bin B, which is better binary. But how do you compile that new version of the C compiler? Answer, with the old one. So you end up with a C to bin better, but it's still running on bin A. Next time. I'd lost my compiler's notes and assembler notes, which did use T-diagrams, but thanks to one of my grad students, Ron Knott, bless you, Ron, who is a complete pack rat, he had rewritten all my notes in much better shape and had hung on to them from 30-something years ago. So I couldn't have made this video without you, Ron. Thank you very much.